Psychiatry is a medical field that requires human touch and empathy. So the question arises, does digital health have a place in it, or is it going to remain an inherently human job? We've taken a look around. Wubot is one of the many apps that aim to bring AI to psychiatry. It's a smart algorithm that serves as a pocket psychologist. And while it can have a good conversation with you and can serve you with helpful tips, sometimes it can get a bit awkward.
Wobot, what are you doing now besides talking to little old me?
User, I'm super anxious and can barely sleep.
Wobot, I can't wait to hop into my jammies later. Z emoji.
Of course, as technology improves, it's going to get better, but can it replace human help? Well, unless apps like these have a chat with someone who is in a grounded emotional state, it can go wildly bad. But what most therapists agree on is that these apps can serve as an introduction to therapy, as most people are afraid to talk about their problems and especially hesitant to seek professional help. But since Wubot is just an app, it's easier to open up. So therapy bots can open a door for people who otherwise wouldn't speak out. But real therapy, for now, is going to stay between two people, sitting and talking to each other. Telemedicine, on the other hand, is a true blessing for therapists and patients. Apps like Cloud9 aim to make mental health care more accessible through a platform offering intervention and prevention support by connecting patients with mental health care professionals. Another app called Talkspace connects users online with over 200 licensed therapists. These services are great to bring care to those who need immediate help and those who live in rural areas with limited access to psychiatric care. Another buzzword in Silicon Valley is VR, or virtual reality, which we mostly use in gaming these days, but they have great possibilities in healthcare too. VR can offer a brand new way to treat mental health problems, such as anxiety, fears, and phobias. In VR, patients can recreate fearful situations to get over their paranoia. For example, a VR app called Arachnophobia offers self-guided exposure therapy for people having an irrational fear of spiders. As you might have guessed, in Arachnophobia, you're going to meet a lot of spiders.
It is the top level, and this is a lot of spiders. They seem to be, are they in the ceiling? They're all over the walls. How many have we got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 total spiders. And I'm waiting for them to like crawl up my arm and bite me or something. So we can use this antidote, but apparently that might not happen.
What's probably the most useful gift from digital health to psychiatry is in pharmacogenomics. Pharmacogenomics is about analyzing how the genetic makeup of an individual affects their response to certain drugs. It can provide explanations to why some people experience side effects when taking certain antidepressants, and it can help psychiatrists to customize drug treatment to achieve better efficiency and tolerability for each patient. So how is treating mental health problems going to look like in 10, 20 years? Let's take the Beauty and the Beast. The beast was pretty depressed, being cursed and trapped as an ugly monster. But his smartphone could have recorded the violent outbursts, the moments of insomnia and late night looking up of internet sites about self-harm. A therapy bot could have made some suggestions how to improve sleep and manage anger, or book him to see a therapist. The therapist then could have suggested therapy and drugs based on the beast's pharmacogenomic information. And even if he hadn't been open to leaving the castle, as he didn't want people to see him as a beast, he could have scheduled the sessions on a telemedical platform. The curse could have been resolved much, much earlier.